coolness is a little bit vague. You could look at coolness as just outward appearance, as not being emotional or not flinching. But it doesn't mean that internally your mind isn't racing or that your emotions aren't exploding. I think of equanimitas as the ruptured aneurysm. When that happens and you get that surge of adrenaline and your hands can shake and your mind can scatter, I mean, all that stuff has to be pushed back and controlled. And you have to almost rise above your humanity to kind of figure things out in the moment.
I think the calm and collected is incredibly important. And I think that not numb, you know, you need to have self-control. You need to have control of your sympathetic nervous system and not let your heart rate race up to 150 beats a minute every time you're having a difficult conversation or there's some issue in the operating room, or at least be able to control it really quickly. But you also can't be completely unaffected when you see a 20-year-old in the trauma bay who's just been in a horrible car wreck and they're paralyzed from the neck down. That if that doesn't make you sad, if that doesn't ruin your day, then you need to take a step back.
You have all seen it, right? That operating room that is just relaxed doesn't necessarily have to be not serious, but a relaxed operating room leads to better performance by every other person in that case and yourself, right? If you're calm and you're under scope, or you're calm performing whatever aspect of an operation, you're obviously going to perform differently. That trickles to the staff, that trickles to your circulator, your surgical tech, anesthesia and neuromonitoring, every aspect of the OR. I think this is the number one key.
We do have people who are able to keep their cool under really intense circumstances. So you can take that breath, even if your heart rate's like, you know, 120 in the OR, and take a beat and think about your next step.
I do better mentally if I keep that calmness. Otherwise, I know that I'm not going to do as well.
Equanimity is learned. It's totally learned because it defies what's happening inside your body. You may feel panic, you may feel fear, all of those rush of emotions in that moment, and it's a learned behavior to just put a lid on all that and to find a way to just, you know, stay laser focused. And I think it's learned by watching people. You guys have all mentioned that. So you see other surgeons not react. You recognize how it affects the room and the mood. But I think that's one of those that it's not natural. You have to learn it and you have to force it on yourself.
If someone has been there before, is calm, cool, and collected, that to me is a surgical master.
You're learning a style of being a neurosurgeon and being a doctor. And so part of it is taking the cues from those around you, your senior residents, your co-residents, and conforming a little bit, right? Like, learn how to do a portrait before you become Picasso, right? You need to learn the fundamentals. And so trust the environment you're in. This is the program you're in. Take the cues. Don't think like you've got a better way to do this, and so you're gonna do it differently. First thing in the code is take your own pulse. Well, I'm going to be that guy who, like, his pulse doesn't go up. He's calm during the code. I'm not going to be all frantic and, like, rushing around and wild-eyed, right? Because that's not the style.
So for me, coolness is just what is visible on the outside. But what's happening on the inside is the ability to compartmentalize this rush of emotion. And then, you know, summoning all of the physical things that are needed to actually execute.
I think this is in The Right Stuff, right, by Tom Wolfe, about the, kind of the beginning of space flight, and they talk about Chuck Yeager and his cool demeanor, right, as the test pilot, the fighter pilot. So the way Chuck Yeager communicated was kind of picked up upon by this generations of pilots, and just like, yeah, you know, it's kind of this kind of chill cowboy type that exudes confidence, and you're going to trust them with this flight.
In the moment, humor is a very powerful diffuser of tension in really critical situations. It could be a glance, it could be a look, or, you know, a smile, and it immediately diffuses a tense situation.
I came across this leadership lecture by an ex-Navy SEAL, Rook Denver, who said calm is contagious. He went on to elaborate to say that calm can be replaced by so many other words. Anger is contagious, scared is contagious, panicked is contagious, stupid is contagious.
I think the good surgeons, they spend a little time thinking about the things that can go wrong, because if it happens and you have to get yourself out, if you've already thought about it and what you might do, then it's like you're just reaching for the plan B and there it is. You don't have to invent the plan B, because that's a lot harder to do under pressure. You know, you guys probably don't see me looking at films in the OR on the monitors, because my routine is to like sit down before I go and just like get those images loaded into my short-term memory. And you know, that's when I think about like, what if this, what if that? And I think it really helps.
Training to become a good surgeon, a lot of that is that visualization, preparation, anticipation.
As you know, athletes visualize those things all the time. I'm no athlete, but I'm a neurosurgical athlete, but I think of this different ways I got out of trouble, similar situations in the past, and this is what experience ends up being. Is experience is simply this collection of tricks that you keep in your memory, this toolbox you pull out as needed.
The choke is the ultimate in lack of equanimity. When athletes get rattled on the court or on the golf course, you just see that loss of equanimity and this unraveling. All of the motion, all of the fluidity, all of the confidence just melts. It's the same in surgery, it's just it's not so visible, because it's, you know, it's surgeon versus disease, and the disease is getting the upper hand in a moment, and the surgeon needs to respond. You have to summon all those things, the control, the detachment, the compartmentalization, the experience, the nimbleness of thought that allows you to just pull it back together and come up with your next move.
If you have the patient solely in your mind during the surgery, right, like, why are we all here? Why did I go to school to do all this? It's for the actual benefit of the patient. If your mind is right, everything else is just gonna follow, right? You're not gonna be the asshole in the OR that's throwing stuff, that's causing, you know, a bunch of commotion, just because that's bad for the patient. Then the case is gonna take longer, then everybody's off their game.
Something as basic as patient first sounds so obvious to a medical student, but it's not until you actually are put in the pressure cooker that you realize how much of a home base mantra that should be, and just a way of living.
Focus on that, then all these things follow.
To me, true excellence is equanimitas.